فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Some people, some scholars, they divided the innovation into two types. Bid'atun hasana, good innovation. Wa bid'atun qabiha, and evil innovation. Such as Ibn Athir. Ibn Athir in his kitab al-Nihayatu, he mentions that the bid'ah, al-bid'atu bid'atani, the innovations are two. Bid'atu huda, bid'ah of guidance. Wa bid'atu dalala, and bid'ah of misguidance, he called it. Also, you can find the same by other scholars. Al-Izzuddin ibn Abd al-Salam, he said the same. Shafi'i said the same. Umar ibn Khattab, they say, Qiyam al-Ramadan, he said, Ni'ma al-Bid'atu hadhi. What a good innovation this is. Imam al-Bukhari narrated. When we know that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kullu bid'atin dalala. Every innovation is misguidance. Rawahu Muslim. Al-Izz ibn Abd al-Salam went on to another extreme and he said that the bid'ah is divided into five. Bid'ah which is wajib, bid'ah which is haram, bid'ah which is mandub, bid'ah which is makruh, and bid'ah which is mubah. Ah. The ahkam al-taklifiyah, he said that the bid'ah is these five. And Imam al-Shatibi refuted Al-Izz ibn Abd al-Salam in this matter, and he said, Rahimahullah, Imam al-Shatibi, he said, لا يدل عليه دليل شرعي. No sharia evidences indicate this. لا من نصوص الشرعي ولا من قواعدي. None of the texts from the sharia show what Al-Izz ibn Abd al-Salam is saying. And not the principles of the sharia doesn't even show that. إذ لو كان هناك ما يدل من الشرع. Because if there was something in the sharia that which indicates that, which is that there's a bid'ah which is wajib, or there's a bid'ah which is manadab, or mandub, or bid'ah which is mubah, لما كان ثم بدعه, then there would not be innovation. If the bid'ah falls into the one of ahkam al-taklifi, then that means it's part of the sharia, then it can't be called innovation. They refuted it. The scholars, they answered the explanation of what is meant by that the bid'ah is two types. Especially the speech of Umar ibn Khattab. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab Iqtida'u Salat al-Mustaqim li mukhalafati ashab al-Jahim, he said that the speech of Umar, which is that the ni'amat hadhihi al-bid'ah, what a good innovation, ni'ma al-bid'atu hadhihi, what a good innovation this is. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said that this is meant by the linguistic interpretation or explanation of the word, not the technical meaning. And that's the definition Umar intended. He meant it, the linguistic definition, not the technical definition. That's one way of explaining it. Some other scholars, they said, Umar's speech has actually come in another narration by Ibn al-Tabaqat, Ibn Sa'ad in his Tabaqat, that Umar said, if this was an innovation, what a good innovation it would have been. So Umar himself did not even affirm it to be an innovation. The third view that has been also introduced in answering the speech of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu is that Umar, when he said this, he meant min babil mushakalati fi ta'bir, is when something is said for it to resemble something, not that it actually means it in reality, such as what Allah said in the Quran, wa jaza'u sayyi'atin, anyone who does a evil, the reward of his evil is what? Sayyi'atun, another evil. Mithluha, like it. Question here right now is that if a person does an evil to repay him for the wrong that he has done to you, is it called an evil? No, it's your right to get what he has done to you. His one is called evil, but your one isn't called evil. So Allah also referred to it as an evil because it's mushakala, just to use the same name, even if it doesn't mean it. And it's as though Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, somebody asked him and said to him, ابتدعت يا عمر, Umar, you've introduced. And he said, if I've introduced, if this is an innovation, then a good innovation it would be. Another example sometimes would be is that somebody would say something to you, and you will say to them, somebody would say to you, you're a Shi'i, you're Rafidhi. And you say to them, like Shafi'i said, لو كان الرفض حب آل محمد, if loving the Prophet's family makes me a Shi'i, فليشهد الثقلان أني رافضي. Let everyone know that I'm a رافضي. Does that literally mean he's a رافضي and he's admitted to be a رافضي? It's called المشاكلة في التعبير. Okay? Brothers, the innovation is two types. Especially now that we're talking about it from the angle of science of hadith. البدعه نوعان. The innovations are two types. بدعه مكفره. A bid'ah which is disbelief. The person leaves the fold of Al-Islam because of it. Okay? أي يكفر صاحبها بسببها. The person will be made a disbeliever due to it. كأن يعتقد. It is like if a person starts to believe ما يستلزم الكفر. Anything that necessitates disbelief. He believes in it. والمعتمد أن الذي والمعتمد أن الذي ترد روايته من أنكر أمرا متواترا من الشرع معلوما من الدين بالضرورة أو من اعتقد عكسه. It is anybody who rejects a matter which has come to us in a multitude narration from the Sharia, a knowledge in which is known out of necessity. Anyone who starts to believe opposite to it. This is what the ulama refer to as bid'atun mukaffira. The second type is called bid'atun mufassiqa. It's a bid'ah which is fisq only. The person becomes a fasiq. Like, لا تقتضي بدعته التكفير أصلا. But it doesn't necessitate for him to become a disbeliever. So what is the ruling of the narration of an innovator? إن كانت بدعته, scholars, they said, this is a rejected narration, right? But it's not just all like that. So scholars have explained it. They said, إن كانت بدعته مكفرة, if his bid'ah led to disbelief, ترد روايته, his narration is rejected. Such as Ibn Arabi, Muhyiddin Ibn Arabi, the owner of the Kitab of Fusus al-Hikam, kafir. His bid'ah has reached kufr. Like the Jahmiyyah, kuffar in their belief. The second one is, إن كانت بدعته مفسقة, if the person's bid'ah is مفسقة, which is the second type. The jumhur of the scholars of hadith are upon the view that two conditions are added to it. If he fulfills those two conditions, even that though he has a bid'ah مفسقة, his narration is accepted. They say, أَلَّا يَكُونَ دَاعِيَةً إِلَى بِدْعَتِهِ, as long as he's not a caller to his innovation. If he's a caller to his innovation, the narration is not taken from him. The second one is, وَأَلَّا يَرْوِي مَا يُرَوِّجُ بِدْعَتَهِ, and the narration in which he is narrated has to not follow his belief. So if a Shi'i is narrating a hadith, and the hadith is of the virtue of Ali, is not taken from him. Because this hadith, it supports, you use it and may even lie because of it, because he wants to push his view. So scholars won't take it. Then Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he said, the last one, inshallah ta'ala, which is su'ul hifd. Su'ul hifd. Which is that the person's memory is bad. Su'ul hifd. He has bad memory. What does it mean, su'ul hifd? أما سيء الحفظ. It means من لم يرجح جانب إصابتي على جانب خطائه. It is anybody who لم يرجح, who doesn't do ترجيح, strengthen جانب إصابته. Sorry, لم يرجح. Sorry. لم يرجح. It hasn't become clear. It hasn't become strong. جانب إصابته, his angle of getting it right, على جانب خطائه, his angle of getting it wrong. It hasn't become clear. Scholars are not able to say that this is the strongest of him. They don't know whether he gets it right or when he gets it wrong. They don't know it. It hasn't become clear. Which of it, the angles of his correctness, they can't distinguish between which one is which. They can't. The types of su'ul hifd. The su'ul hifd is divided into two. يَنْقَسِمُ su'ul hifd ila qismain. Is divided into two. Lazim. Lazim means a bad memory. Su'ul hifd is bad memory. It is attached to the narrator. It's connected to him. غير منفك, it's not separate from him. It stuck to the narrator. In all of his situations, nothing came to him. It's just naturally how he is. The second one is Tari'un ala al-Rawi. The narrator was never like this. This matter came to him later. Why? Maybe he grew older and he's old now. Or his eyesight went. Or his books got burnt, in which he used to rely on. And this is what the scholars, they refer to as what? This one, which is the second one. Which is the one whose memory changes. Because it used to be strong. It changes. The scholars, they call this one a mukhtalit. A person who mixed up. They call it a mukhtalat. A person who mixed up. He mixed up. That's the second one. So if the narrator, what is the ruling? What is the ruling if the narrator has bad memory? What is the ruling regarding his hadith? Anyone whose memory was always like that, he grew up like this, his whole entire life he was known to have bad memory. فَرِوَايَتُهُ مَرْدُودَةٌ His narrations are rejected. As for the second one, الْمُخْتَلَطُ مُخْتَلَط is the one, الطَّارِعُ عَلَى الرَّاوِي. It is something that happened to him, which is the second type, right? The second type, huh? Which is the one who mixed up. فَالْحُكْمُ عَلَى رِوَايَتِهِ To give a ruling regarding his narration is التَّفْصِيلَ الْآتِي is as follows, with these conditions. فَمَا حَدَثَ بَعْدَ اخْتِلَاطِ Anything that he narrated before he mixed up, وَتَمَيَّزَ ذَلِكَ And the scholars of hadith are able to distinguish between it, then the narrations prior to that is accepted. وَأَمَّا مَا حَدَثَ بَعْدَ الْإِخْتِلَاطِ As for what took place after his mixing, فَمَرْدُودٌ is rejected. The other one, which is the one who وَلَمْ يَتَمَيَّزْ It didn't make, the scholars of hadith are unable to distinguish between what? قَبْلَ الْإِخْتِلَاطِ أَوْ بَعْدَ When he mixed up, before or after, they can't tell. تُوُقِّفَ بِهِ حَتَّى يَتَمَيَّزْ Yes, scholars, they withhold from him until it becomes apparent. They withhold from him until it becomes apparent. Now, let's go back, brothers, on a very important topic. Let's go back according to what Ibn Hajar said to his book. فَالْأَوَّلُ The first type. Who remembers what was the first type, hey? The first one that we took when we called طَعْلُ فِي الرَّاوِي الطَّعْنُ فِي الرَّاوِي When we started it, what did we say the first one was called? كَذَّب, صح? Ibn Hajar is not going to take you back to each one. What is it called in hadith? The one who lies, what is his hadith called? الْمَوْضُوعُ Fabricated. That hadith is called fabricated. Fabricated hadith is a hadith which is made up on the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. The narration, pay attention, which is due to the lying on the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that hadith is called mawdu'. What does mawdu' mean linguistically? Huwa ism maf'ul. Mawdu' linguistically is a ism maf'ul. And it comes from what? Wada' al-shay. To place something. Wada' al-shay. Min yadihi is to place something from your hand. Okay? Why is it the hadith called wada? Because the person places it down. It goes down from its level. The reason why it's called linhitami, linhitati rutbatihi, because of the, when somebody places something down, what happens? It puts it down, right? The hadith has gone down. That's what it means linguistically. That's what it means. Technically, it means huwa al-kadhibu, it is to lie. Al-mukhtalaqo, which is made up. Al-masnu'u al-mansubu ila Rasulillahi, which is then ascribed to the messenger, alayhi salatu wa salam. A person forges, he makes up a hadith on the messenger, alayhi salatu wa salam. Al-Khattabi, rahimahullah, in his Ma'alim al-Sunan, and Ibn Salah, in his Ulum al-Hadith, they said that إِنَّهُ The hadith which is موضوع إِنَّهُ شَرُّ الْأَحَادِيثِ الضَّعِيفَةِ Is the evilest hadith which are weak. Scholars have actually become amazed with that speech of Khattabi and Ibn Salah. They said that's not right. Because the موضوع, it's not from the hadith of the messenger. It's not even weak, Aslan. It's not weak. It's fabricated. It's fabricated. Because they said, when you say, إِنَّهُ شَرُّ الْأَحَادِيثِ الضَّعِيفَةِ, it is the weakest, the evilest of hadith which are weak. Then the ulama of language would say, أَفْعَلْ is تَفْضِيل. Is you're doing comparison. So then some of it will be compared to the rest. So you're scribing it to the messenger, but it's weak. Or there's a reasoning. The scholars, they said, that's not the case. A hadith which is made up, which is wad', has no basis whatsoever. No basis. No basis. A hadith which is weak, hadith which is weak can be due to a person's memory being bad. There can be some basis. There might be some reasons why this hadith might become sahih, and etc. حكم روايته. What is the ruling of this narration? أجمع العلماء, the scholars are on a unanimous agreement, على أنه لا تحل روايته لأحد عالم حاله في أي معنى كان إلا مع بيان وضعه. The scholars, the person who narrates a hadith which he placed it, what is the ruling regarding that narrator? The scholars are in a unanimous agreement that it's not permissible to take hadith from that person. Anyone who lies about the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do those people who place the hadith, what parts and what means do they take? They have two ways how they do it. The ones who fabricate a hadith, and they're called wadda'in. They are called what? Wadda'in. People just forge and make up statements. Fi siyarati al-hadith, the form and the method which they do it for, or the reasonings behind and the means in which they do it, are two. The first one is, imma an yunshi'a al-wadda'u al-kalama min indihi. The person will forge the statement from his own self. And then after that, we'll make a chain of narration for it, and then he will narrate it to the Prophet. So the wordings are from him. He chooses the wordings. He makes it up from his own self. Then he thinks about a chain of narration. He gets that chain of narration and ascribes it to the messenger. The second one is, no. وَإِمَّا يَأْخُذَ كَلَامًا لِبَعْضِ حُكَمَاءِ وَغَيْرِهِمْ وَيَضْعَ لَهُ إِسْنَادًا. Or he takes a speech of those wise people and those proverbs and sayings, and he will take it and say, that's nice. Oh, by the way, let's say that the Prophet said this, and he makes a chain of narration for it, and he will ascribe it to the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. How can a hadith be recognized? How can it be recognized that the hadith is fabricated? The scholars, they mention ways to realize it. The scholars recognize it without even looking at the chain of narration. They recognize it. There are matters these are matters without us looking at the chain. These points that we're going to mention are nothing to do with the chain. It's before looking at the chain. It's just hearing the hadith. The scholars of hadith had ways to understand. The first one is, which is the simplest one, إقرار الوضع بالوضع. The one who made the hadith up would admit to it himself. He will admit to it. Like Abi Ismata, Nuh ibn Abi Maryam. Nuh ibn Abi Maryam. He admitted that he placed فضائل سورة القرآن سورة سورة. Every surah, he made a virtue for it. A virtue for it. And he forged it against Abdullah ibn Abbas to the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. So he admitted it himself. He said it and admitted it to himself. The second one is ما يتنزل منزلة إقراره. Something that can be placed that can be as though he affirmed it himself. Which is the second one. It can be as though, second one is, as though he admitted to it. And how is that different from the first one? It is different from the sense which is, he narrates from a teacher or person. And then he's asked about when he was born. They ask you, when were you born? And he tells when he was born. And they find out that the teacher died before his birth. And that hadith is not known except through him. So, and he clearly lies and says, حدثني فلان, فلان told me. Alhamdulillah. And so the scholars say, when were you born? He says, this time. When did so-and-so, and they know so-and-so, when they died. So it's as though he admitted to it. Because they found out what time he died. And what time this guy was born. So the scholars, they say, ما يتنزل منزلة إقراري, it can be placed in the placing of him admitting it.